Hi, welcome. My name's Virginie. I live here since 8 years completely off-grid next to the woods in the Belgian Ardennes with my husband and 2 kids. My husband and I, we drove around here in Wallonia each weekend, I think for about 5 years almost, to look for the ideal house for us. And we wanted to have a house that was really somewhere in the middle of the woods or not even in a village. We want to be really outside of all. So, and we've been looking until we found something here in 1999. We don't have any electric cable from the power net coming to our house. At first we want to have that, but when we asked for the price, it would cost us about 220,000 euros, which made us almost faint. So my husband, who is already a good electrician, he asked an even better electrician, one of his good friends, to conceive and to build a standalone system here, and in which they succeeded wonderfully. So we have the principle is we have like solar panels which provide the electricity and which is stored in an array of batteries. And next to that we have, in case of power shortage or not enough voltage, we have a generator that serves as a backup, and when it turns on, it also supplies power to the batteries. Well, the house, it's a very old farmhouse which was not in a good state at all. So the previous owner, he just did some small works, but he didn't do really thoroughly, so we had to redo everything. We saw the house and we said, okay, we're gonna have to build practically a new house, but we want to keep the general appearance of the old original house. But we knew we had to tear down everything, the roof, which was not okay. We saw lots of things were rotten, and we knew what we were starting with, but you always have surprises when you do renovations. So yeah. Right now, originally this was the cow stable of the old farmhouse. We still found the floor when we did the digging to make the floor nice afterwards. And this will be the dining room afterwards, after it's finished. As you see, there's a chimney that's from the Finnish stove we have here in the middle of the room. And we're gonna build like a turning staircase around the chimney. So there will be like stone steel cylinders fixed around the chimney, and then around there will be like a wooden staircase in combination with a mezzanine. You can say like 90% of all the works has already been done, but the last 10% usually it's the most difficult part, and we're still waiting to have a staircase installed here and a mezzanine which will divide this place still in the height. It's very nice to have like this church-like height, but it's not it's not supposed to be like this. Because of wood shortage and stuff like that, we still have to wait for this, as well for the kitchen. So when the staircase is there, we can go into our bedrooms, have our bathrooms properly installed. So voilà, we still have quite some work to do, but the end is in sight. Yeah. In the beginning, of course, you're not very sure of yourself, although the environment makes us very happy. But living off-grid, for us, it was also a new situation. Sometimes there were problems with the electricity. Just at the moment, my husband was abroad, and because I didn't have any power anymore, I couldn't use a phone anymore. So I had to run uphill to have some signal with my mobile phone. I had to ask him what's happening. And he said, like, I had to run back to our bunker with all the electric installations in there to see what was going on. And I had to run back up to tell my husband which lights were on, alarms here and there. So in the beginning, it was quite thrilling. But now I'm used to it. Whenever something happens, I just go to the electric cabinet. I see, okay, that switch, it's switched off. Okay, it should be that problem. You get used to it. Before we had the well, I went to the village, to friends of ours, to have like this two big water cans filled every week to brush our teeth with and to boil our water for tea and coffee. So things have gotten lots easier, but still there's some work to do. But yeah, it's an adventure. When you switch on a light or like an electric appliance, you always have to, yeah, okay, can I do this? Is it safe? You have to think about it. We don't take things for granted here. I think that's very important. Actually, we wanted to really find a house that was as isolated as possible, not in a tiny village even. We want to be outside the village. And it was just something we felt like we want to live in the middle of nature. I've been a countryside girl when I was small. We both lived in Antwerp in the middle of the city until 2013 for over 20 years. And we just felt it was not our place at all. And when we found this house, it felt right. It felt just the place we had to go and live. For renovating the house, we were also very principally inspired, for instance, not using PVC. Also for the electric cabling, it had to be certain materials that were not harmful, because lots of people don't realize in lots of building materials or materials you use for renovating or even electricity, water, drainage and stuff, lots of harmful substances are used. And we wanted to avoid this as much as possible for our health, but also for our natural environment here. Yeah. We're in the kitchen area right now, which is still makeshift, as you can see. The new kitchen will be installed next week with a delay because of shortage of wood right now. And it will be oak, like a solid oak, the door panels. And lots of this oak will be from recuperated material from the original house. This is not a passive house, but it's a low energy house, as they call it. What did we do? So the walls were already very thick, brick walls, but we added these huge bricks against the wall on the inside. And in between everywhere, there's a foam glass insulation. And also, finishing with insulation made of wood fibers. And to finish it off, we had people putting on a loam coat and also a natural finishing with a coloring, a pigment in it, so we don't need to paint afterwards. We had a well drilled a couple of years ago. It's about 65 meters deep. The water we have is very clean, it's very good quality, but just to make sure for drinking the water, we use additionally a Berkey filter, which is also without any plastic, with activated carbon filters in there, and it works perfectly. The water tastes nice, and for the rest, we use it for everything except for the toilet. We use rainwater. So the wastewater, we had to build our own water purification station also to get the building permit. So it works completely natural. It's like with these little lava granules, and we have storage of sewage waters, and it gets filtered in the small field. And after filtration, when it's clean enough, it actually goes into the ground. Thank you. This is bear garlic. So this is a very tasty plant. Now it's already in full flower, so we don't use it anymore. But until a couple of weeks ago, we've been cutting it, well, the leaves, to make pesto of it. And the flowers, I used also a couple of them to eat in a salad. And it's very healthy. It's they call it bear garlic because it's supposed to be the first food that a bear eats when it comes out of its hibernation, and gives a lot of energy and necessary nutrition. So it's supposed to be very healthy. We got a lot of wildlife here as we are next to a big forest. We've got wild boar, we've got roes, we've got deer, raccoons, beavers, black storks. So that's why we put the game camera here, which is triggered by movement and temperature. So it's very interesting. So we filmed quite a lot of beavers already. Raccoons, unfortunately, too. And herons and also black storks, which was amazing. Just yeah, so, and this is like a passageway for beavers and raccoons here. They come from the river, cross the river, and then they all have their fixed spots to make a crossing, and here they make their descent into the pond as well. For heating, we only use the wood from our own land. So usually it's wood we just pick up, trees that have fallen, branches that have fallen from trees. We use it also for cooking. So we got also a Finnish stove here that works on firewood. And everything comes from our own land, which is like within a radius of 400 meters. So no transportation, pollution either. So it's, people say, okay, it's a lot of fine particle dust you create with the wood, and just to when you burn it. But of course, we don't use regular stoves here. You have like a second combustion, so we have less waste coming out of the chimneys as well. So it's quite thought over, I think, yeah. So here we're in the technical heart of our house. Here the power from the solar panels comes in and is converted to the power we need to create the electricity we need to run all the appliances in our house. Eventually the electricity is stored in these 12 batteries over here. So even at night we have power supply without having to run, for instance, our generator here, which serves as a backup, especially during winter times when there's not enough light from the solar panels. It will start up automatically, it provides electricity to the house, and in the meantime, it will also charge the batteries. So this is the control panel of our electric heart of the house here. For instance, this is the control panel to manually start and stop the generator. Here, for instance, we can do the readout of a percentage of the charge we still have in the batteries, and then different switches with which we can control to what part the power has to go, and also to charge the electric car. But therefore we have to run the generator because it's three phases. So, voila. I've always been close to nature since I was a child. I always told my parents I was either gonna be a vet or a farmer. I think I ended up with a bit of combination of both right here. We've got animals, sometimes you have to take care of them when they got little ailments and stuff like that. We live in the middle of nature. I have a large vegetable garden, a greenhouse. So the farmer stuff, you can say I'm like at least half a farmer. But yeah, it's already since I was a child. I love being outside. I was interested in reading about animals, about nature. So yeah, it's since my childhood, it was already in me. I'm afraid even sometimes for my children, what life they will have afterwards in I don't know, 20 or 30 years. And it worries me, and I just hope the governments of the whole world will start realizing it's almost 5 past 12 instead of 5 to 12, just to take action and to do some real substantial stuff that will still be able to change the situation. This is our office. Even after renovation works, this will stay our office. And I've always been translator, interpreter, but I've traveled so many times to China and I couldn't stand the pollution and overcrowded conditions anymore. And I thought I have to find something which puts my private life and my professional life more in balance. And then I thought about opening up an eco-conscious web store with zero waste items, natural items, ecological linen products from Finland and things like that. And it allows me to stay here in this beautiful house and beautiful environment, and I can do my work from home. So I think it's the ideal combination for me.
Thank you for watching. Hit the notification bell so you never miss an episode. Questions or remarks, post them in the comments down below. If you like our video, just click the subscribe button so you never miss an episode. Thank you for watching.